Aloha everybody, this is Christopher with AG Productions, and welcome to another Watch Me Work on a High Elf Chariot. What we're going to do today, very quickly, is just kind of have a little sit and chat here. We're going to talk about composition of a miniature. In other words, how to get the miniature to look different ways by doing different things to it. In this particular case, we're going to be talking about assembling the model. Now, we just finished up working on the first of the lions for the chariot, and what I'd like to do to kind of vary things up and break things up and kill the monotony, not just for myself, but for you guys as well also, instead of moving to the other lion, I'd like to move to one of the people, one of the elves that are actually going to be manning the chariot. Now, I've got two options. I've got the guy that's going to be standing upright, or I've got this guy that's going to be sort of leaning on the edge of the chariot. He'll be leaning, let's see here, where does he kind of fit? Sort of like so, I think. Something similar to that. Kind of like there-ish, I think. I'd have to actually put the guy together. It's like that. It's more like that. Okay, there we go. See? I knew it was something. There we go. Okay, so he's kind of like leaning on the side of the chariot. They've even grooved out the back of his armor back here. I don't know if you can see that little groove to kind of fit into this little slot over here. All right. Now, for me, either one's fine. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to work on the guy that's standing upright first because, truthfully, if I work on this guy, the guy that's sort of bent over, what I'm going to have to do is I'm going to have to, every time I want to highlight the guy, put him back on here and try and figure out where the highlights will be hitting the body. Whereas this guy, who's standing pretty much upright, I could just hold him and figure out where the highlights are going to go. And so it's going to be a little bit easier to work on him first. Now, that being said, let's take a look at some of the options for the models, okay? So let's take a look real quick at the cape of the miniatures, all right? So you've got two of these lion capes right here. All right, let me get them in frame. There we go. Now, this is very, very simple. When you're assembling this, one cape doesn't fit on one of the miniatures, all right? But it does fit the other model very, very nicely, very easily, all right? This guy, however, if you'll look at it, they've done this for you to make it easy, has a cape that's kind of out, like the wind is blowing it. So if you had the option of maybe having two of these style capes to have the wind blowing both capes, you should be able to utilize this same cape on this guy as well. Maybe get on eBay, pick up an extra cape or something like that, and have yourself two very nice flowing capes, so it gives the illusion that the chariot is moving very, very quickly. With this sort of static, stationary cape on the guy that's standing upright, it kind of detracts in some ways from the movement of the forward movement of the miniature, because you've got one guy whose cape is blowing wildly in the breeze, and then one guy whose cape is just laying behind him. And unfortunately, I don't have another flowing cape. I could probably buy one, but generally speaking, most of the bits dealers that I deal with won't sell individual parts. They'll sell pieces of kits, that like combine groupings of things. So they might sell, both the capes and some weaponry and some accessories to go on the chariot. I don't need that. I just need an extra cape. And so, for me, I'll just run it right out of the box. But one of the things that you can take a look at is varying stuff up that they do give you. One of those things being the heads of the miniature, and that's what I want to talk about today. So let me kind of get this in. I'll tell you what. Let me give you an idea of how it looks first, and then I'll show you exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, so you got your chariot here, all right? And then this guy stands basically in this position. You can see that the chariot has two holes here, and those holes fit little pegs on the foot of the miniature, all right? So these feet just drop down into these holes right here, and the model essentially stands at a slightly sideways angle on the chariot. So you can see he's facing somewhat sideways right there, all right? Very, very simplistic look, very easy, nothing, out of the ordinary there. Now, in his both left and right arm, at some point, I will attach them to the model, and they will be holding reins that attach both here and here. All right, and each of those reins connects to a lion's head. All right, so his arms are taken up by reins of this chariot. Now, I've got two head options here, and let me show them to you both. All right, I've got this one here. I don't know if you guys can see this or not. Let me try and zoom in and get a good close-up shot on this. That might be as close as I can get. Okay. All right, now I've chosen to go with the uncovered heads. There are covered heads that you can use. In other words, armored helm heads. But I've chosen to go with the uncovered heads because I think it looks a little better. But you've got this guy who's got his mouth open like he might be screaming or saying something. All right. And then you've got this guy who's a little bit more ornate, a little bit more composed, let me see if I can get some of the light out of there. There we go. All right. You see the other side of that guy's head? All right, there you go. Nice and simple. Very composed, very elvish. All right. This guy, very fierce, almost a warrior look to his face. Okay. Now, in my initial working with this, I thought to myself, okay, let me take this guy that's got the yelling, screaming kind of warrior look, and I'm going to put him on this guy that sort of sits on the side of the chariot, because this guy that sits on the side of the chariot is going to be holding this axe right here, all right? And my thought was, you know, if this guy's sitting on the side of the chariot waiting to hack down some guy that's walking next to the chariot or that they happen to run by, you know, the warrior head might be a pretty darn good option. Or the one that I'm calling the warrior head because it's a little bit more animalistic and barbaric than the other one. Okay? All right. And then I said, okay, just for, you know, grins and giggles, let's swap it and put it on this guy. All right. And we put it on this guy. And I noticed something about this one. All right, first of all, the head's got to be turned to the right, because remember, the guy's basically facing sideways, okay? But I noticed something about this head when attaching it to this guy. It almost adds a sense of, a sense of strength to the miniature, like he's doing something or in the middle of something that's causing him a lot of exertion. And the more I thought about it, I thought, you know, this guy's holding a lion in each hand. I mean, that's a lot of work. And the open mouth might not be like a battle cry. He might be yelling commands to the lions of which ways to go. All right. And then I thought, okay, well, let me just test and put the other head on. The one I would call the more regal, elvish style head. Very simplistic, very composed, and to me, at least, not as exciting. It doesn't convey any hint of strain. It doesn't convey any hint that this guy is exerting himself at all. And I got to thinking, you know, which of the two guys is going to be under more stress and more strain most of the time? And odds are pretty good it's going to be your driver, the guy that's controlling these gigantic beastly lions the whole time, versus this guy that's sitting on the edge waiting to pass an enemy so he can hack him down. So what if I put the head on this guy? All right, and I put the head on this guy, and now he looks like he's waiting. He doesn't look like he's in the midst of battle. He looks like he's anticipating running across the next enemy. And so what I've decided to do because of that is set the heads up in that manner. I've decided to go with the slightly more warrior barbaric style head for the driver, and the slightly more elegant elvish head for the guy with the axe. And as I said, it's all about composition. You know, I could swap them out, and it might look okay. I mean, it might. But to me, just doing a little bit of play testing, a little bit of work, swapping things around, and just sort of testing where I think things ought to go, for me at least, this is the layout to go with. You guys remember when we first got started on this project a while back? You know, we tested the lines to see which ones worked on which side of the model. Very, very similar concept. All you're doing is basically trying to take what you've been given in the model form and making small little nuances of change to where things are positioned in order to give you the most interesting miniature possible, okay? And so, I mean, it's like I said, it's not a big change. You're not doing any major conversion work or anything. All you're doing is very, very selectively choosing where certain pieces of the miniature are attached to that miniature. All right. And in doing that, it really dramatically changes the model. There was a miniature that I had a while ago. It was a pirate miniature from a company. I can't remember what the company was called, but the line of miniature was called Ron and Bones. It's a discontinued line now, unfortunately. But there was a pirate miniature that I had, and I did a video several years ago. And I believe the video is called 1 Millimeter Makes All the Difference. And it's very similar in concept to this. And if you've never seen it, if you're one of our newer subscribers, I would encourage you to go look at it because it explains how you can shift things just a little bit on your model and create massive increases in interest for that miniature. So, like I said, just a quick little video talking about the composition of the miniatures and how it's going to be put together. Now, some of you may be wondering, all right, let me set this guy aside. And the axe and the chariot, we'll put that aside. Let's get this cape out here, because that's part of our model. And then this little lion head is going to be part of it as well. Let's scoot this guy over so he's in frame. How about doing that, too? I'm going to leave this guy unassembled prior to painting him. The reason being, all right, so let's take a look at this. If I attach the head to the miniature, all right, I'm going to have great difficulty getting underneath the hair of the miniature over here where it's right next to the shoulder pad. And I'm also going to have difficulty painting the shoulder pad. I'm going to have difficulty painting around the neck of the miniature. Oh, excuse me, yawning. My goodness. It's late in the day. I'm going to have difficulty painting around the neck of the miniature if I attach the head ahead of time. All right, and it's just, to me, until I actually get this miniature on the base here, or on the model, so I can know exactly which direction that head needs to face, to me, it's just a wiser idea to leave it off, allow yourself the ability to paint the model, and then put it together later on. And that way you don't miss any of the areas or get paint where you don't want it or something like that. Same thing for the cape. There's absolutely no reason to attach the cape prior to painting the miniature. I'm going to miss a lot of detail back here. This is all going to end up just solid white if I go ahead and attach the cape now because there's no way I can get a brush to it. Now, I know what you're saying. You know, why paint something that once it's covered up, you're not going to be able to see it anyway? And you're right. Odds are pretty good. What I'll do is just coat this very, very gently in a dark, dark gunmetal gray or gunmetal silver and be done with it. And, you know, I'll add some details into the areas that I can see. Now, what that does mean is that as I'm highlighting the back area of this miniature, I'm going to need to attach this cloak or at least sort of drape it over his shoulders every now and again just to get an idea of, you know, which areas specifically need to be highlighted versus which don't. Same thing goes for the cloak. If I put it on the model prior to painting, I'm not going to be able to access the inside areas of the cloak. Whereas if I leave it off, I've got complete access and no problem painting those areas. And by the way, if you've never painted a miniature like this, it's not that big of a deal. I know a lot of people, I know myself, when I first got started painting miniatures, I assembled everything ahead of time. And what I found was that there were certain miniatures where if I put everything together ahead of time, there was no way certain areas of the model were going to be painted. I just couldn't access them with a paintbrush, and it became very, very frustrating. And so I learned after about 4 or 5 months, It's okay to leave a model unassembled before you paint the miniature. It's fine to paint things separately and then put them together later on. The only areas where you might have some difficulty in doing something like that is, for instance, if we take this other guy. Let me kind of move this stuff out of the way. All right. And let's put this guy's arm on. So we are arms and weapon. All right. So the only area where you might have some difficulty is something like this, wherein you've got something like where his wrist down there connects with that arm. There will be a dark line of just sort of blankness when you attach this later on, as opposed to if you paint it right now, you can kind of paint over that line if you attach it ahead of time. So there are certain areas that can get affected if you assemble a miniature after painting versus prior to painting. But for me, ease of access to the areas that need to be painted is far more important, and it gives me the ability to do the best work that I can on a miniature. All right, so some models, like I said, I will assemble prior. Some models I will assemble after painting. Just a couple of quick ideas for those of you that may be newer to the hobby, or that, you know, maybe have never tried assembling a miniature after you paint it. And like I said, just a couple of quick ideas on composition. Check out that video, 1mm Makes All the Difference. I'll make sure to put it in the video description, if I can find it, of course. Yeah, that's all I got for you guys today. Like I said, just a quick little video with a couple of ideas and helpful tricks and tips for you. If you have any comments or questions, drop them down in the comment section down below. Also, be sure to leave a thumbs up on this video and subscribe to AG Productions if you haven't already done so. Thank you very, very much for watching. I do appreciate it. Have an awesome rest of the day. God bless you all, and I will see you all in the next video.